So today we have the fourth lecture on the CMSA and Tsinghua lectures on history and literature of mathematical science. And Joe Harris is going to be in charge. Joe.
Okay. Well, we're very fortunate to have with us today Claire Voisin. She really does genuinely need no introduction, but I will say that at the Summer Institute in Algebraic Geometry in Seattle in 2005, I heard her described as a force of nature, and that is still the most apt characterization I know of. So Claire is going to be talking on the topology of algebraic varieties and Hodge theory, and with that, I'll leave it up to her.
Thank you for the invitation, of course, and thank you for the introduction. So the subject, the general subject is very large, and so I had to make choices. So the subject started with the work of Hodge, which is a fundamental and much more general than the topology of algebraic varieties. But I will just, so it's a work in analysis and different geometry. So I will just describe the result that we are going to use, but not really enter into that part of the story. And I decided instead of insisting on the fact that the apparently tiny arguments from algebra, building on the work of Hodge, and I would say mostly developed by Deligne, led to incredible statements on the topology of complex algebraic varieties. So I will, of course, describe this argument in some detail. The second point that I want to also algebra, describe what I mean, Hodge structures, mixed Hodge structures, there are general definitions and categories and how they work. The second very important point in the whole subject is the notion of polarization, which is very extremely important in the to prove statements, but which is rather painful. And it is also directly coming from the work of Hodge, and there is no way to get, so there are signs conditions that appear in the whole the structure. And so there is no way to go around the work of Hodge. Again, I will take them for granted, and then I will explain how we can use these polarizations, especially to distinguish Keeler geometry and projective geometry from the topological viewpoint. So what will be completely missing in my talk, and really I'm not happy about that, is the theory of variation of Hodge structures, which was invented by Griffiths, and which uses all of these arguments, all of these ingredients. But I had no time enough, so I will need a second talk. So I start with the general context, which is that of complex geometry, or a complex manifold. It's a manifold in the usual sense, where you have selected an atlas that is a local system of local charts, local coordinates, which take a value in a open set of C to the N. And what you ask that the maps of holomorphic of a change of coordinates are holomorphic. So, and now when you have a complex manifold, you have a weaker structure, which is that of, which is called an almost complex structure. Namely, just the structure of a complex vector bundle on the tangent bundle. You get it by saying that the local holomorphic coordinates identify locally your manifold with open sets of C to the N. So the tangent space will be identified to the tangent space of C to the N, and so to C to the N itself. And so, of course, that gives you the complex structure in local holomorphic coordinates. And then you use the fact that the change of coordinates maps are holomorphic. That means that the differential is C-linear. So these various locally defined complex structures give an almost complex structure. And so, well, of course, when you want to go back from the data of an almost complex structure to an actual complex structure, you need an integrability condition, which is due to Newlander and Nirenberg, which is of Frobenius data. So you know you have a notion of a Hermitian metric on X. This is simply the Hermitian metric on the tangent bundle equipped with this complex structure. So in local holomorphic coordinates, the Hermitian metric will develop as a sigma of IG of HID DZI tensor DZD bar, where the matrix HID is of course infinite in the coordinate, and it is at any point it's a Hermitian matrix which is a positive definite. So the real part will give the Riemannian metric, and the imaginary part turns out to be a real two-form, which so it is said to be of a type 1-1 because when you develop it, so you find this formula where you see only one DZ and one DZ bar in each monomial pairing, and the coefficient omega IG is just the imaginary part of the Hermitian matrix HID. And so this is, you get a real two form, which is of type 1-1. And the fundamental definition is that of a Keller metric. The Hermitian metric is Keller if this two form is closed. And then the omega between brackets will denote, will be called the Keller class. So this is the cohomology class of this, the Ram cohomology of this Keller, of this closed two-form. So the projective case, so if you consider complex projective space, you can construct explicit Keller metric on them. Well, the CPN, of course, it's a set of vector lines in some C to the n plus one. Each time you give you a Hermitian metric on a C to the n plus one, you can construct Fubini, an associated Fubini study, Keller metric on CPN. It turns out that the formula giving this Keller class gives it as a curvature form of a connection on the Hopf line bundle, or rather it's a dual. And so as a conclusion, you get that the Keller class in that case, it is the first term class of the dual of the Hopf line bundle. And so it is integral. And similarly, if you have any complex submanifold of CPN, so it's what we call a projective manifold, it will have the property that by restriction, it has a Keller matrix with a Keller class, which is an integral degree two cohomology class. And conversely, we have the famous Kodeyer-Hamilding theorem, which says that this last property characterizes the projective manifold. Those complex manifolds of CPN, namely a compact Keller manifold is projective if and only if it admits a Keller form with integral cohomology class. So the only if is just the observation made before, but the difficult part, of course, is the if. So now I want to discuss the Frobenius spectral sequence of a complex manifold. It's a very general thing which exists in the general complex geometry setting, but also, if I arrive at that point, it also exists in as well in algebraic geometry. So let me discuss this. So with my complex manifold has a local holomorphic coordinates, z1 to zn, so n is the complex dimension of x. So you have then the holomorphic vector bundle omega x. So this is the holomorphic sections are the holomorphic one forms on open sets of x, so sigma of fi dzi, where the fi are holomorphic functions of the coordinates. The transition matrices are given by holomorphic Jacobian matrices. And then you build the holomorphic Gorham complex, where in the degree k, you have the shift of holomorphic k-fold, and you have the exterior differential from omega x to the k to omega x to the k plus 1. And I wrote a theorem, so the lemma, the holomorphic Poincaré lemma, says that this complex is exact in a strictly positive degree. and this is a resolution of the constant shift C. So this is saying that if you have a holomorphic form of a strictly positive degree, which is closed, then it is locally the differential of a holomorphic form. And the last statement is simply saying that if you have a holomorphic function f such that df equals zero, it is a constant. So as a corollary of this, what is important for us is the fact that then you can compute the cohomology of x, hk of x with the c coefficient, so the shift cohomology. You can compute it as a hypercohomology of the holomorphic Durham complex. So of course it's not maybe the classical viewpoint, so I decided to give a talk without Nolbaum cohomology. Hypercohomology, that means that you will choose your favorite acyclic resolutions of each of the omega and omega xk. So usually we should choose the Dolbeau resolution, take a global section so that gives you a double complex, take the associated simple complex, compute its cohomology. So in any case, we just put it in the form of a package, saying this is hypercohomology of that complex. In any case, this is the right formula to introduce easily the Hodge filtration. I put Hodge with a quotation mark because Hodge didn't do anything at this point. On this holomorphic Durham complex, you have the filtration. The old people called it the filtration bête, or stupid. Let's say that this is a Hodge filtration, just by the truncation, that is FP omega x dot is the omega x, the subcomplex starting with omega x to the p, and then you continue. So that gives you a decreasing filtration on the holomorphic Durham complex. And so associated to this decreasing filtration, so you will have the Hodge filtration on the hypercohomology, where we get FPHK of XC defined as the image of hypercohomology of X omega X dot greater than or equal to P, image of this into the hypercohomology of the whole complex. And also, because it's the hypercohomology of a complex, you have the what is called the hypercohomology spectral sequence, which is exactly associated to this filtration, and that we call the Frölicher spectral sequence. So by generalities on hypercohomology, the E1PQ term of this Frölicher spectral sequence is the cohomology of x with value in the shift omega x key point in the story is that this resolution, unlike the usual Durham resolution, it's not an acyclic resolution because these shifts are not acyclic. Okay, so on by generalities on the spectral sequence is the infinite PQ term of this spectral sequence. So it will be a subquotient of the E1PQ term determined by the differentials in the spectral sequence, and they are the greux for the Hodge filtration of the abutment, which is our HK of X. This is very general, and that exists in the general setting. So now I would like to discuss something which is sort of a generalization, which will allow to compare well the cohomology of a complex manifold and the cohomology of a complex manifold minus a closed analytic subset. So I'm in this situation, X is a complex manifold. I choose I suppose that I have a complex analytic subset Y, and I will call U the complement X minus Y. So the first thing to do is to blow up by Hironaka. You can blow up successively X along the smooth centers, all supported on over Y, so that you do not change the U. So that at the end, the complement of U is made into a normal crossing divisor, that is the union of smooth hyperspaces surfaces meeting transverse. Or if you prefer, the Y is defined locally by a single holomorphic equation, which is a product of coordinates. So the number of k of coordinates appearing, of course, will depend on the open set. That is, you have a number of branches of your normal crossing divisor, and according to the open set you are, we will meet a certain number of branches, and that depends on, of course, on the open set. So, and then in that situation, on introduce the so-called logarithmic Durham complex. First of all, you define the vector bundle omega x of log y, which is in these coordinates, the holomorphic vector bundles generated over the sheaf of the holomorphic functions by dz1 over z1 to dzk over zk. So they are the coordinates adapted to the y, and then dzk plus 1, dzn. And then you consider the omega xk of log y, so you define it to be the wedge k of this holomorphic vector bundle, and you see that easily that there is the exterior differential maps omega xk of log y to omega xk plus 1 of log y. So it's very easy to represent explicitly your forms using this representation of the generator. The sections of the holomorphic Durham complex, there are forms with a logarithmic growth along y. You can characterize them as those holomorphic forms which have a pole order 1 along y, such that the differential also has a pole order 1 along y. And so there is a theorem, which is in fact really a local computation. Saying that so of course this the logarithmic Durham complex it is made of holomorphic forms with a certain growth, the logarithmic growth. So it is certainly contained in the complex of all holomorphic forms on U with arbitrary growth, that is, this is exactly a G lower star of omega U, which is a complex on X parameterizing containing all holomorphic forms on U. So the result is that the inclusion of the subcomplex of forms with the logarithmic growth is a quasi-isomorphism. And the corollary is that you can compute the cohomology of your open set U as the hypercohomology of the logarithmic Durham complex. The reason is that you combine the HK of U with complex coefficient by the previous result. It is the same as the HK of U with value in G lower star of omega U. And it is and then you use the theorem, the fact that you have a quasi-isomorphism to replace this G lower star omega U dot by the logarithmic Durham complex. And now when you have this formula, which is exactly similar to the previous one, you have exactly by the same kind of argument, a Frobisher spectral sequence and on HK of UC, you will get a whole geofiltration, which is deduced from the Hodge filtration on the logarithmic Durham complex. One can note here that, of course, we also have the original formula that HK of UC is the hypercohomology of U with value in the holomorphic Durham complex of U. So, in some sense, you could define two Hodge filtrations using these two different formulas. But the filtration, the naive filtration on the complex. In fact, the right one in some sense, so this one is a finer and it is the right one for doing project theory. This one does not usually not very much used because, for example, if U is a fine, the filtration you get is not interesting. Okay, so now the contribution of Hodge in to this subject is fundamental. It is much larger, much broader than the context of a complex geometry. It's the general setting will be that of say oriented Riemannian manifold. Let's say it is compact also to simplify, so you can make integrals. And there is a L2 metric on form, so the L2 matrix is given, it's represented as follows. So when I have two forms on X, their L2 intersection alpha beta L2, it will be the integral over X of alpha wedge star of beta, where star is called the Hodge operator, which passes from k forms to n minus k forms, where n is the dimension, real dimension of your x. So this star operator allows to construct the so-called formal adjoint d star, which is computed as a plus or minus, so that depends on the degree of star composed with d composed with star. So it is a formal adjoint in the sense that you will get for any alpha and beta. Alpha, the pairing between the L2 pairing between alpha and d beta is the same as the L2 pairing between d star alpha and beta. In this sense, it is a formal adjoint. And then you introduce the Laplacian delta d, which is d composed with d star plus d star composed with d. With this notation, the harmonic forms are those which are annihilated by delta d. And you can see easily using the formal junction property that if X is compact and alpha is harmonic, that is annihilated by delta D, then alpha is closed. In fact, this is equivalent to alpha being both closed and co-closed, is also annihilated by this star. And the fundamental theorem of Hodge is that in each Durham cohomology class, there exists a unique harmonic form. Harmonic forms are closed, so they have cohomology classes, and they represent uniquely the cohomology classes of course, say real or complex Durham cohomology classes. You get unique harmonic representation. And so the application to complex geometry will be mostly in the Keller setting, not only, but in this talk. So on a complex manifold, you have the notion of forms of type PQ. So there are those which are locally written in the form sigma of alpha IG, DEI, wedge DZ, D bar, where you have only cardinality of the index set I is P, cardinality of the index set J is Q. So this is a PQ form, and it's very easy to see that any K form with complex coefficients, so I'm thinking of complex C infinite differential forms with complex coefficients can decompose uniquely as a sum of forms of type PQ. And using this representation by harmonic forms, Hodge proves that if X is scalar, when you start from a form of type PQ, then the Laplacian of applied to this form is also a form of type PQ. And in particular, so this will produce plenty of harmonic forms of type PQ, namely if you start from any harmonic form alpha, you decompose it uniquely as a form of the sum of forms of type PQ. Alpha is a sum of alpha PQ. And then you get that each alpha PQ is a harmonic. So that splits, that will split the cohomology class of your alpha into the sum of cohomology classes of forms which are both closed and of type PQ. So I don't say anything about the way this is proved, because it needs the introduction of another Laplacian related to the delta bar operator. So I didn't want to speak about that. So that's why the presentation is a bit not complete. So in any case, you're going a little further. You can define inside HPQ Q of XC, you define HPQ of X to be the complex vector subspace made of cohomology classes of closed form of type PQ. So there are two statements. First of all, this space HPQ of X is in fact isomorphic to the cohomology of X with value in omega X to the P. So here X is a compact compact Keller. And furthermore, the cohomology of the Greek K with complex coefficient HK of XC is the direction of these subspaces HPQ of X. So you observe that by the definition of the HPQs, the complex conjugate of HPQ is the same as the HPP, because simply the complex conjugate of a closed PQ form is a closed QP form. A corollary of the Hodge decomposition theorem is the fact that the Frobisher spectral sequence of X degenerates at E1, which means that the E1 is equal to the A infinite. The reason is that the dimension of the A infinite PQ is always smaller than or equal to the dimension of E1 PQ. The decomposition theorem together with this complement here tells you that the HK of XC has a dimension of BK of X equal to the sum of the dimension of the E1 PQ. But also by definition of the infinite PQs as graded pieces, we know that the BK of X is the sum of the dimension of the infinite PQ. So we have this corollary. So I have no, I cannot explain, so it will be the subject of another talk. But already that statement, without any further qualitative development involving Hodge structures, that statement about the degeneracy at E1 of the Frobisher spectral sequence has very, very strong consequences, in particular in deformation theory. For example, there is a famous Bogomolov-Tian-Todorov theorem saying that if you have a compact Keller manifold with a trivial canonical bundle, then its deformations, deformation of its complex structure, are unobstructed. This theorem uses only the degeneracy at E1 of the Frobisher spectral sequence, and not the whole statement of the Hodge decomposition theorem. Okay, so that was of course a big contribution of Hodge, and now I am going to develop more algebraic constructions around this Hodge decomposition theorem. So so we are going to discuss Hodge structures and the category of Hodge structure. So the definition of a Hodge structure of weight K, this will be an integral Hodge structure, that it is the data of a lattice, torsion-free, finitely generated abelian group. Use a decomposition on the complexified lattice LC, so this is L tensor C. I give me a decomposition of E into the direction of a complex vector subspaces LPQ. The sum is over pairs PQ with P plus Q equal to K. And I ask the Hodge symmetry that I want that the complex conjugate of LPQ is LQP. When you have a Hodge decomposition like this, you have an associated Hodge filtration. You define the FP LC as the direct sum for R at least P of the LR K minus R. And conversely, from the Hodge filtration, you can recover, this is an equivalent datum. From the Hodge filtration, you recover the LPQ by a formula that LPQ is FPLC intersected with the complex conjugate of FQLC. 4 pi plus q equal to k. But you cannot do this for starting from any filtration. There has to be a condition on the filtration. And the condition is here. You take a filtration on the LC, and you need that it is opposite to its complex conjugate in this that Fp is in a direct sum. So the direct sum of Fp and Fk minus p plus 1 complex conjugate gives you your LC. And once you have this, then you can construct a Hodge decomposition and a Hodge structure by this formula. So there are variants. The variants, of course, is to speak about a rational Hodge structure where the L will be a Q vector space. And another variant, which is important for geometry, is that you can ask that your Hodge structure is effective. Namely, you want that the LPQ are zero if P or Q is negative. We have the notion that they form a category. We have the notion of Hodge structure. So the morphisms of between two Hodge structures, they will exist only if their weight k have the same parity. So say respective weight k and k plus 2r. The morphism between both is given just by the morphism of lattices or q vector species in the context, which preserves the Hodge decomposition up to a shift, that is a shift of by grading by RR. So I want that phi c of LPQ is contained in L prime P plus R Q plus R. Equivalently, phi c of FP is contained in FP plus R. So for example, if you consider the effective weight one Hodge structures, they have a geometric interpretation. Namely, consider the compact complex tori. There are compact quotients of C to the N by discrete co-compact lattice gamma. Associated to this quotient, I have this inclusion of gamma into C to the N. If I complexify this inclusion, I will have a surjective linear C-linear map from gamma C to Cn. The kernel of this inclusion will give me a complex vector subspace gamma 1, 0, of a dimension n, and you can show that it satisfies the condition that gamma 1, 0 plus gamma 1, 0 bar is the role of a gamma c. So that gives effective weight 1 Hodge structure. And in fact, it's an equivalence of categories. If I wanted to consider only where effective rational weight 1 Hodge structures, I will consider on the left complex tori up to isogeny. That is, you fix, you consider only the H1 or the gamma tensor Q. So now there is a point that the category of rational Hodge structure, Hodge structures, is not semi-simple. You can see this geometrically. There are non-trivial extensions. So for example, geometrically, for the weight one case, say that you can have a surjective morphism of a complex tori, so T surjects onto T prime, which do not split up to isogeny. So that is, you can of course translate this in the language of a weight one Hodge structure. So that exists already starting from dimension two. It's a phenomenon that we could not see in algebraic geometry because if your complex tori are algebraic, then a surjective map like that will always split up to isogeny. And precisely, the missing ingredient would be polarization. And the proof of the existence is just by counting the dimensions of the parameter spaces for the complex tori admitting a surjective morphism like that, and the complex tori being the direct sum isogeny. You see that we do not have the same number of parameters. So now the Hodge structures we are going to study, of course, they come from geometry. So the Hodge decomposition theorem can be rephrased in the form that if X is compact Euler, the cohomology, the integral cohomology modulo torsion, I wanted this, take the watershed, carries an effective Hodge structure of YK. The decomposition I will put on the complexification here it will be the Hodge decomposition. So the functorialities, the most obvious functoriality is that if you have a holomorphic map between two, say phi, between two compact Keller manifolds, you can consider the pullback phi upper star from cohomology of Y to cohomology of X. This is a morphism of Hodge structures. This is very easy. When you complexify, you observe that because phi is holomorphic, the pullback of a closed holomorphic of a closed form of type PQ on Y is a closed form of type PQ on X. And by the definition I gave of the HPQ, this is saying that the phi upper star maps HPQ of Y to HPQ of X. Now, a slightly more delicate statement is the fact that the Gaussian morphism phi lower star, which is like an integration over the fiber, from the cohomology of X to the cohomology of Y minus 2D, so D is the relative dimension of the morphism, so different of the two complex dimensions, is also a morphism of Hodge structures. I don't want to give a geometric proof, simply it says that in fact it follows from the compatibility of the formal argument and the compatibility of the Hodge structure with the Poincaré pairing. So the explanation is that, first of all, more or less by definition, via Poincaré duality, the Gaussian morphism of the phi lower star is the transpose of the phi upper star, of course, in the adequate Poincaré complementary dimension, degree, pardon. So we have this statement. The second fact is that, when you have a weight k Hodge structure, you can define a Hodge structure, say, of weight minus k on the dual. Very simple. So the dual Hodge decomposition will have for a term by degree minus p minus q, the orthogonal complement, the orthogonal of the direction of the LRF. It's obvious the decomposition that you get on the dual. And so we have this duality. And then you observe that the Hodge structure on H2n minus k of XZ, it is a dual, Poincaré dual, to the Hodge structure on HK of XZ, up to a shift of B degree. Of course, here we want to have a Hodge structure of weight 2n minus k, and not a Hodge structure of weight minus k. So you first dualize to a Hodge structure of a weight minus k, then shift everything by degree nn, and that gives us the correct Hodge. And this is simply, this follows formally from the observation that when you consider the Poincaré intersection pairing, the integral over x, alpha pq, wedge, alpha, beta, p prime, these integrals, which describe the pairing in cohomology, this is zero when p prime is different from n minus p, n minus q. And so, finally, combining the three, you get that proposition. A formal construction now is the fact that when you have two Hodge structures on L, respectively M, of weight A and K prime, then you construct a Hodge structure of weight K plus K prime on the tensor product L tensor M. But you just have to say what is the PQ part of LC tensor MC. It's just, you can imagine the formula, that take the direct sum of the LRS tensor L prime, R prime, S prime, for R plus R prime equal P, S plus S prime equal P. So it's just a tensor product for a bigraded object. So now let me discuss the relationship between the functoriality and for Hodge structures and the Hodge classes. So now I consider a Hodge structure of even weight 2k, hold a class for this hold structure will be an element of the L, the lattice, if it is a integral hold structure, or the Q vector space, if it is a rational hold structure, an element of L, but which is also of type KK in the hold decomposition, that is in the middle part of the hold decomposition. So it's formal, it follows exactly from the definition that the Hodge classes on L star tensor M, so if you have L Hodge structure of weight K, M of weight K plus 2R, of course L star tensor M is just a set of morphisms of, from L to M, then the Hodge classes are exactly the morphisms of Hodge structures from L to M. So just look at the various definitions, various definitions of morphism, definitions of dual, definition of tensor product, and you arrive at this. So and in particular, the corollary, you get that the Hodge classes on a product X cross Y of compact Keller manifold identify with the morphisms of Hodge structures from the cohomology of X to the cohomology of Y with a shift by even the number to R. So this is a fixed degree and consider the morphism that exists. And if I get a morphism of Hodge structure, that will give automatically a Hodge class on the product. So so an example, of course, an example of a Hodge class when you have a is given by the so-called cycle classes. So suppose that you, in a complex manifold X, you consider a closed analytic subset Z of codimension K. It has a cohomology class Z between brackets, which is an integral cohomology class of degree 2K. Well, I don't comment on this. I just say that it is very easy when Z is smooth, and then you have to say something when Z is this singular, but when X is compact Keller, this cohomology class is a Hodge class, an integral Hodge class, and the Hodge conjecture is says that the expectation that if X is a smooth complex projective manifold, then the rational Hodge classes on X are algebraic, that is generated over Q by these cycle classes. Well, it's a widely open conjecture. So let me give an example where we really don't know. It's a very simple example. When you have any X, say smooth projective, as a morphism from the cohomology of X to cohomology of X, you just consider the identity of HK of X or Z. So there is so you will have one a delta K, which I call delta K for each degree K. And this delta K by this corollary will give a Hodge class on X cross X. And it is a, in most cases, we don't know that they are satisfies the Hodge conjecture. The Hodge conjecture, it is the only main case, main non-trivial case where it is known. It is the case of degree 2, which is called the Lefschetz 1-1 theorem, which is very particular in that case because it works with integral Hodge classes, and there is a very good version working in the general compact Keller setting involving the C1 of a holomorphic line method. But it is also using the Hard-Lefschetz theorem that I will mention soon, true in degree 2 n minus 2, where n is a dimension of x. Otherwise, it is wrong even a weaker form of the Hodge conjecture, where you replace the cycle classes by chain classes of analytic coherent shifts. Is wrong in the compact Keller setting, something that I proved about 15 years ago. So, what I want to discuss now is a generalization of order structures, which is due to the Lin. So I mentioned, so it's obvious when you study algebraic varieties that you cannot restrict to smooth productive ones. You need to know something about the singular ones, about the quasi-productive ones. For many reasons, there are not so many sub-varieties. If you restrict to the smooth ones, then you don't get enough information. So the theory of a mixed Hodge structure, it's very nice because it applies not only to the compact setting, but to the projective setting, but to the general case. Also, it includes the singular object. So the definition is due to Galin. So I will just consider the rational coefficient case. A rational mixed Hodge structure, so it will be the data of Q vector space L with an increasing filtration, which is really defined by a rational subspecies, which is called the weight filtration, and a decreasing filtration, which will be called the Hodge filtration, which is now on the complexified vector space LC, as before, with the following property. I want that the if you consider the induced filtration on G I W L should be LC defines a Hodge structure of a weight I. So the induced filtration, so you have the FPLC, you intersect with a WI LC, and then you project modulo W I minus one LC. So that gives that induced filtration. And as I mentioned at some point, when you have a filtration that does not always determine a Hodge structure. There is this condition of being opposite, etc. So this is the statement. What is hidden in this definition? And the theorem of Dunning is that the cohomology of quasi-projective complex varieties that is allowing singular ones and quasi-projective ones, the escape set in a projective one. Or more generally, you could consider analytic Zariski open in compact Taylor manifold, that is a complement of closed analytic subset. You could consider also relative cohomology or homology of such pairs. All this carries functorial mixed Hodge structures. I didn't say right now what are the morphisms. I'm coming to that very soon. So let me say quickly how this works in the the smooth case, so it's a very, very fundamental result. Let me explain in the smooth case how you get the two filtration. It's very explicit in that case. You can use so the smooth case, the quasi-projective X minus Y. As I already mentioned, you can always assume that the Y is a normal crossing divisor and say inside an X, which is a compact Taylor. Then we use the formula that I mentioned, that HK of UC, it is a hypercohomology of the logarithmic Durham complex defined by the normal crossing divisor Y. And then on this logarithmic Durham complex, there are the following two filtrations. The filtration F, which is just by the naive or stupid Hodge filtration, the truncation. So this is, we already met it. But now the weight filtration is very easy up to, well, the numerology in that theorem is very hard, but up to a shift, the WI will be simply the following, that defines the WI omega x dot of log y to be omega xy of log y wedge omega x dot minus I. What does that mean? That means that you consider a subcomplex where you have only you allow only how to say forms with poles along k along I branches of your divisor. You don't see the higher intersection with more than I branches. So that gives you a filtration. For example, the W0, you simply do not allow any similarities. You just have the homomorphic Durham complex of your X. So you have these two filtrations that will give, but after taking hypercohomology, that will give you the two filtrations, W and F, on HK of UC. Well, I said that the degree is not correct here. What is absolutely not clear in this construction is that the filtration W that you get on complex cohomology by this construction is in fact already defined on rational cohomology. It turns out that this is true because you can compare it to the Lorentz filtration of associated to the inclusion map from U to X. And the statement in that case is that these two filtrations are together define a mixed Hodge structure. And a non-trivial byproduct of the proof, which comes with the proof by Deligne, which consists in doing somehow applying Hodge theory on the components of the normal crossing divisor. Non-trivial consequence is that the spectral sequence for the Hodge filtration, that is the Fröhlicher spectral sequence, degenerates at E1 for the logarithmic de Ram complex, exactly as it was in the projective and compact Keller case. And the spectral sequence for the W filtration degenerates at E2, which means that for the Lorentz filtration, the Lorentz spectral sequence degenerates at E3. We understand very well what is the complex what is the A2 of that complex. So in that nice case, it's the easiest case. The smallest weight part of the Greek cohomology of the U is in fact the image of the restriction map from the cohomology of X to the cohomology of U. So that follows more or less from the definition here. So now I want to discuss, I said that it will be much about algebra. I want to discuss the morphisms of a mixed Hodge structures, and they have an extraordinary property, which is a tiny algebraic property. So the morphisms of a mixed order structure, basically, there will be the morphisms between the two Q vector species, which preserve the two filtrations. That is, phi of the WIL contains WIL prime, and same for the Hodge filtration. Of course, it could also allow shifts, in fact, for example, introduce an integer R, and ask that the phi of WI is contained in WI plus 2R, and then you have the condition on the FP that phi C of FP is contained in FP plus R. So we could allow a shift like this. Now, there is this result by Deligne, which is really pure algebra, saying that the morphisms of mixed Hodge structures are strict for both filtrations. And what is the meaning of this strictness result? Is this? It says that if you have let's state it for FP, if you have something which is both in the image of phi and in FP, then it is in the image phi C of FP. And similarly for W, if you are in WI and in phi, that means that you are in phi of WI. So this is a rather subtle notion, and the theorem, this theorem by Deligne is an immediate consequence of an algebra lemma concerning the mixed Hodge structures, namely that they admit functorial decomposition. Of course, it's when you do a tensor C. Similar in the form to Hodge decomposition, namely that the LC splits as a direct sum of the LPQ species, which correspond to in fact the PQ components of the various Hodge structures coming in the graded pieces for the W filtration. So this functorial decomposition into a direct sum of PQ species has a property that on the Hodge side, you recover the FP as exactly and as in the smooth case, as the sum of the L R Q for all Q and R at least P, and for the W I, it is the direct sum of the L P Q for P plus Q non greater than I. And once you have this decomposition, the strictness property, it's very obvious because so let's do it for the weight filtration. So you have an alpha which is in WI prime and which is in the image. You write alpha as a phi of beta. The beta is decomposed using this result into a direct sum of a PQ component. But then phi of beta PQ is equal to zero for phi plus Q strictly greater than I because you apply the functionality of this decomposition and the fact that your alpha is in WI prime. And so you conclude that your alpha is also phi of beta prime, where you just take for the beta prime, the sum of the beta PQ for P plus Q non greater than I. Okay, so it's all pure algebra. But now, let's see an example of application. So that contains the so-called co-niveau of cohomology. It's a very important notion in the theory of motifs. I say that the class alpha in the cohomology of X, so let's say that X is a complex manifold, is of a co-niveau at least C, if alpha restricts to zero on the Zariski open set X minus Y, for some closed analytic subset Y of X of codimension at least C. So suppose that X is a smooth compact, then you can apply Poincaré duality on cohomology. So cohomology class of the degree K, that will be the same thing as a homology class of the degree 2n minus K, and the condition, this vanishing condition, is equivalent to alpha coming from a homology class supported on Y. Okay, but now the strictness theorem of the line implies the following result, that suppose that X is a smooth projective and Y contained in X is a closed analytic semi-algebraic subset with a designation Y tilde mapping to X, so that's given by G tilde the induced map from a designation of Y to X. So, and what says the line, the very deep topological statement, is that the image of a G lower star, so you look at a homology of Y, you can because of your Y is singular, but there's always a G lower star in the homology. So what says the line in that case that the image of G lower star is the same as the image of G tilde lower star. Of course, everything is contained in the homology of X. So it's absolutely non-trivial. He's saying you have a class which is supported. So suppose that you have a homology class supported on something which is singular. It already it comes from a class on the designation. So it's absolutely it's not a general topological statement. You need a lot of structure to get this. And as a corollary, you get that the set of cohomology classes of co-niveau at least C, it is in fact a Hodge substructure of HK of XQ of a Hodge co-niveau at least C, because it is by this result, it is the image of a Gaussian morphism from the cohomology of a smooth projective variety Y tilde. And your so Hodge co-niveau at least that means that HPQ is zero for where when P is smaller than C or Q is smaller than C. And this is clear because it is the image of a Gaussian morphism which shifts the by degree by C, at least. Okay, so it's an example where you have this purely algebraic argument, which at the end gives you an incredible topological statement. I mean, very strong topological statement. So I discussed, I spent a lot of time discussing mixed Hodge structures, which are really the algebraic notion which make many things work. Now there is another crucial ingredient to understand the topology of a projective complex manifold or a compact Kellogg manifold, more projective in fact, which is the notion of polarization. So I start with a hard Lefschetz theorem, which was in fact proved by Hodge, and which is the following. So suppose that you have a compact Keller manifold of dimension n, and omega a Keller form on X, so with a Keller class omega between brackets. The hard Lefschetz theorem says that for any k non greater than n, the map of cup product with omega to the n minus k, which is called the Lefschetz operator to the power n minus k, from hk of xr to h2n minus k of xr is an isomorphism. So the both species are Poincaré dual because the dimension of x is n. But now we say that we have this hard Lefschetz isomorphism. And now a big difference between the projective case and the compact Keller case is the fact that we can take the class of the Keller form to be rational. And in that case, there's a hard Lefschetz isomorphism. They are already defined over Q, and they produce isomorphism of Hodge structures between HK and H2N minus K. So this is a really fundamental difference from the viewpoint of the Hodge structures. There is a corollary which is a direct consequence of the hard Lefschetz theorem, or that is, you need the hard Lefschetz theorem in all degrees to get this. This is the so-called Lefschetz decomposition. You conclude that HK of XR is a direct sum of, so here you put the so-called primitive cohomology in degree K minus 2R for all R such that K minus 2R is non-negative, and you push it to HK via the Lefschetz operator to the power R. And what is a primitive cohomology? Primitive cohomology, so you have the on cohomology of degree K minus 2R, you have the Lefschetz isomorphism, which is L to the N minus K plus 2R. But primitive is when you are annihilated by L to the N minus K plus 2R plus 1. So, well, we have this decomposition, which is really something, it comes from a representation theory. In fact, it's really not very hard. The pure algebra starting from the hard Lefschetz isomorphism. What we are going to do using this is that we can introduce still with an omega which is chosen, which is called the polarization usually. You can construct the Lefschetz intersection pairing on cohomology of degree k. So the alpha beta, the Lefschetz intersection pairing between alpha and beta for alpha and beta of degree k, so HK of xr will be the integral over x of ln minus k alpha cup beta. And it's useful. Well, this Lefschetz intersection pairing, it is symmetric when k is even and skew symmetric when k is odd. So it is useful to introduce the corresponding Lefschetz Hermitian intersection pairing defined by this formula. H lef of alpha beta is I to the k of alpha beta bar. So that gives you a sesquilinear non-degenerate intersection pairing on a cohomology, complex cohomology of degree k. What is easy again? It's for tape reasons. Is that the fact that the Lefschetz decomposition is orthogonal for the Lefschetz intersection pairing, and the Hodge decomposition is orthogonal for the Hermitian Lefschetz intersection pairing. These are called the Hodge-Riemann, first Hodge-Riemann relation. And they come directly from this fact that I already mentioned, that the integral over x of alpha pq range beta p prime q prime is zero unless p prime q prime is equal to n minus p n minus k. So this is really, I mean, there is nothing in, the, in that that statement. But what is very hard, which comes from and that can be proved only by the Hodge theory, is what is called the second Hodge-Riemann bilinear relation. And this is the statement that now you consider your Lefschetz Hermitian intersection pairing. You restrict it to so first to the Rth component of in the Lefschetz decomposition, so this Lr hk minus 2r, but then you restrict this, so this one still has its Hodge decomposition, so you will have finally a Hodge Lefschetz decomposition by subspaces like this Lr hp minus r q minus r of x, sorry, it's c here, since it should not be this r, primitive cohomology. So you have these pieces of Hodge Lefschetz, Hodge plus Lefschetz, or Lefschetz plus Hodge decomposition. And the statement of the second Hodge-Riemann bilinear relation is that when you restrict this Hodge Lefschetz Hermitian intersection pairing to this complex vector surface, what you get is a definite Hermitian intersection pairing, which has the sign. And the sign, it is up to a global sign depending on the degree of p plus q, okay, equal p plus q. This sign is basically it's minus one to the p plus r. P plus r. So that is when you go from p q to p minus one, q plus one, the sign will change. When you pass from one piece of the Lefschetz decomposition to the next piece, the sign will also change. So this is it's very complicated as a rule. But that's the situation we are faced to. So, and so the conclusion, so of course we don't like this situation with this Lefschetz decomposition with this form which change a sign from one piece to the next piece. So the trick in order to construct what we call polarized Hodge structure on the cohomology of a smooth projective manifold, we do the following trick. The omega is chosen to be rational. So we have the Lefschetz decomposition, which is a decomposition into Hodge substructures. And what we are going to do is that on each piece, we are going to multiply the Lefschetz intersection pairing by minus one to R. And then you do the direct sum, the direct orthogonal sum of all these this pairing, and you will get at the end a polarized Hodge structure. And in polarized Hodge structure, it's much simpler. There is this intersection pairing, which is defined under Q, satisfying the first Hodge-Riemann relation. But for the second Hodge-Riemann bilinear relation, you just ask that your Lefschetz intersection, your Hermitian intersection pairing is a definite of sign minus one to the p on the HPQ part. So that is, we get this way, we get rid of this alternance when passing from R to R plus one. So why it is important to introduce this polarization is the fact that the category of polarized Hodge structures behaves in a much better way than the general category of Hodge structures. I mentioned that the category of Hodge structures is not semi-simple, but the theorem, easy theorem, is that the category of polarized Hodge structure is semi-simple. I mean, of course, a rational polarized Hodge structure. The category, the object will be the Hodge structures which admit the polarization. And the morphisms, they are just the morphisms of Hodge structure. And the equivalently, we want to show that if you have a rational polarized Hodge structure, and hold your substructure H prime for any H, then I say that the H split has a direct sum of two Hodge structure. And the proof, it's again it's pure algebra. You choose a polarization on H, and first the important point is to prove that when you restrict your polarization, your intersection pairing to the Hodge substructure H prime, you get something which is still non-degenerate. And this is here that you are going to use H, the Hodge-Riemann 2, because you have these Hermitian intersection pairing, which are positive definite or negative definite on the PQ pieces. And once you have this, you just define the orthogonal, the H double prime as the orthogonal complement of H prime, and you check that it is a Hodge substructure by the first Hodge-Riemann relations. Okay, so I have to mention something which is important for the theory of motifs. That is, as we have seen, on the cohomology of smooth positive varieties, by choosing a polarization, that is a class, rational Keller class, you can construct polarizations on their Hodge structures. They are almost motivic, that is, natural, obtained by integrating over algebraic subsets. But in fact, it's not completely true because we made a non-trivial operation, namely, we had this, we started from the Lefschetz intersection pairing, used the Lefschetz decomposition, changed the sign of the Lefschetz intersection pairing alternatively on each component. And to make this operation motivic, we need, for example, to know that the Lefschetz decomposition can be constructed motivically, that is essentially by using the action of so-called correspondences on X, that is cohomology classes of closed algebraic subsets of X cross X. And this is exactly what will be provided by the Lefschetz standard conjecture. That is why the Lefschetz standard conjecture, the statement is the following. Suppose that X is a smooth projective over C. Then for each case, it's a K non greater than the dimension of X. There exists a codimension K closed algebraic subset. In fact, I should say, formal combinations with Q coefficients of these objects, so the codimension K cycle in X cross X, such that the action of its cohomology class will be a Hodge class on X cross X. It will give, as I already mentioned, a corresponding morphism between the cohomology of X in degree 2 and minus K and the cohomology of X in degree K. And I want that this is the inverse of the Lefschetz isomorphism. The inverse of the Lefschetz isomorphism, it is also a morphism of Hodge structure. So by the Hodge conjecture, it will be given by the action of an algebraic class. It is very important to state this conjecture separately, even if it is implied by the Hodge conjecture, precisely because if we know this, then the category of cohomological motifs has these good properties of being semi-simple, because then it will make the Lefschetz decomposition motivic, etc. Okay. So now I want to discuss completely different applications of the notion of polarization. On the whole structure on the cohomology of a projective manifold. So this is a work of me, and I don't know if you talk about history. I'm supposed to speak about my own work, but so in case I wanted to mention some application for very algebraic nature of the notion of polarization. The topology of projective and compact Kalman manifold. So this is an extra algebraic definition. So the definition is that of a cohomology. First of all, a cohomology algebra, what I will call a cohomology algebra, is just a graded algebra of finite dimension over Q, a graded commutative. And I assume that in a certain degree, so a certain even degree, it is a Q, and that there is a Poincaré duality in the sense that if you take the product from AK, the tensor A to N minus K to A to N, this is a perfect pairing. So that will, yeah. And so typically, the cohomology algebra of a real-oriented manifold of dimension 2n will give a cohomology algebra. So the formal definition is that of a Hodge structure on a cohomology algebra. This will be the data of a Hodge structure of YK on each AK, such that the multiplication map from AK tensor AL to AK plus L, given by the course algebra structure, is a morphism of a Hodge structures for any KL. Typically, when you consider the cohomology algebra of a compact Keller manifold, it has a Hodge structure on its cohomology algebra given by the individual Hodge structures, given by the Hodge decomposition on each cohomology group. And the fact that it is that gives us, if you put all of them together, that gives a Hodge structure on a cohomology algebra. It is just the fact that the wedge product of a closed form of type PQ and a closed form of type P prime Q prime, it's a closed form of type P plus P prime Q plus Q prime. So when you consider when you translate this on the Q product, the structure of the Q product, this is saying that HPQ tensor HP prime Q prime is mapped to HP plus P prime Q plus Q prime. And this is exactly the definition of a morphism of a Hodge structure. Okay, and so I used this notion and and of course polarization to conclude that starting from that complex dimension at least four, there exists compact Keller manifolds whose cohomology algebra is not isomorphic to the cohomology algebra of a complex projective manifold. So let's say with Q coefficient. So here dimension four, that came out of my construction, but in fact it's optimal. That was already known in dimension two by Codeira, that compact Keller surfaces can be deformed, and it can deform the complex structure, so that does not change the topology, to projective complex surfaces. So you have a family, you start from a compact Keller surface, you can construct a family of complex surfaces with one fiber being the original one and other fibers being projective. And the same, in fact, most fibers, done set of fibers being projective. And the same result was proved recently by Sui-Yung Lin, my former PhD student, in dimension three, that any compact Keller X has a small deformation of the complex structure which are projective. And so now what is the idea of the proof for this theorem? So the idea that we are going to construct a compact this compact Keller X with a complicated cohomology algebra. So that is you have a lot of information contained in this product. That's why I need to be dimensional form. Now, I want a cohomology algebra rich enough so that if you have a Hodge structure on the cohomology algebra, the weight one Hodge structure on H1 or H2, if I want to construct simply connected examples, so that I will have no H1, must have endomorphisms of Hodge structures. These endomorphisms, they will be really produced, forced by the structure of the cohomology algebra as an algebra. And of course, the fact that the whole structure have to be compatible with all the multiplication. Okay, so I do this. And then the second point is the fact that certain endomorphisms, I mean, certain conjugacy classes of endomorphisms of Hodge structures, say, acting on a weight one Hodge structure or on a weight two Hodge structure, prevents the existence of a polarization. So, for example, for the weight one case, this is by this equivalence of categories between complex tori and weight one effective Hodge structure. This is saying that certain complex tori, certain conjugacy classes acting on complex, or certain endomorphism acting on complex tori, prevent them to be projective or cannot exist in the projective situation. Well, you need some argument to prove this. So maybe I don't say more about this. So okay. So I stop for this application of polarization, and now I want essentially to conclude with another major application of now the conjunction of two tools, namely the mixed Hodge structures on one side and the polarization on the other side. So the first statement will use essentially only the polarization or the hard Lefschetz isomorphism, so it could be stated in a more general setting. But let's, so it was in fact discovered early by Blanchard and then rediscovered by Deligne. It is very nice. You consider a smooth projective morphism. Well, in principle, that it is not saying much about the total space or the base. It is really a statement about the fibers. The fibers should be smooth projective varieties, or more precisely, you can think to it as a vibration, topological vibration into smooth projective varieties. But when you say smooth projective, that means that you want that there is a line bundle on the monomorphic, in fact, a complex line bundle on the total space whose restriction to the fiber is an ample line bundle. Say holomorphic if you prefer, but the statement could be more general. And the theorem is that if you are in this situation of smooth projective morphism, the Lorentz spectral sequence of F with Q coefficients degenerates at A2. So this statement is completely wrong with the Z coefficients because there are many examples even in the complex projective setting of non-degeneration at A2 of the Lorentz spectral sequence with Z coefficients. And typically, the theory of Brauer-Severi varieties relies on this phenomena. But with Q coefficient, we have this statement. So the proof is totally formal. So the assumption is that I have a line bundle on the total space. So I have its cohomology class. It is an H2 of the total space. It acts on the whole cup product with this cohomology class, acts on the whole Lorentz spectral sequence. And furthermore, so you fiber to fiber, so because of the restricted line bundle is supposed to be an ample line bundle, fiber to fiber, it will you will have the Lefschetz isomorphism. So you will get the Lefschetz decomposition on the local system, RK, F lower star Q. Into the direction of primitive cohomology in the fibers. And then we want to prove that all the DR are zero, but let's just prove that the D2 is zero in the Lorentz spectral sequence. So suppose that you're using the Lorentz using the Lefschetz decomposition, it suffices to prove D2 alpha equals zero for alpha in HP, but the A2PQ term, the HP of Y, RQ of F over star Q. But by the Lefschetz decomposition, you can restrict proving the D2 alpha equals zero on HP of Y with value in RQ F over star Q, primitive part. But then that means that Ln minus Q plus 1 alpha is a zero, because we are in the primitive cohomology. By compatibility of L with the differential of the Lorentz spectral sequence, we get that Ln minus Q plus 1 D2 alpha equals zero. But the key point is that D2 alpha now will be in HP plus 2 of Y, RQ minus 1 F lower star Q, and the Ln minus Q plus 1, it is the Lefschetz isomorphism in that degree. So this vanishing here will imply that D2 alpha equals to zero. So that it's really totally formal. I like this kind of trick. So in any case, what we get as a consequence? Associated to this this topological vibration, we have these local systems, RK, F lower star Q, and choosing a reference point zero in Y, we have a monodromy representation from the fundamental group of Y based on zero to, let's assume that the Y is connected, to the automorphism group of HK of X0 Q. And then by generalities, the invariant part of HK of X0 Q under the monodromy representation is just H0, so the first term in the Leray, the first two term in the Leray spectral sequence, namely H0 of Y, RKF lower star Q. But now the degeneracy at A2 of the Leray spectral sequence will say that you have the surjection from HK of XQ to the H0, the A2 K0. To zero K term. So the degeneracy to the Lorentz spectral sequence tells us that the invariant part under the monodromy action, it is the same as the image of the restriction map from the cohomology of the total space. And now there is what is called the global invariant cycle theorem by Delligne. Now I am in the case where X and Y were quasi projectives. The F is a morphism of algebraic varieties, for example. So I take a smooth projective compactification of X, and I assume that both X and Y are smooth. Then what Delligne says that in the invariant part HK of X0Q, invariant part under monodromy, it is the image of the restriction map from the cohomology of X bar to the cohomology of the fiber X0. So the difference between the previous statement is now we have extended the cohomology classes not to X, but to the projective compactification X bar. And the proof, it is a mixed Hodge structure argument, simply because the restriction, we know already that this is the image of the restriction map from H, from the cohomology of X. The restriction map HK of XQ to HK of X0Q, it is a morphism of mixed Hodge structures. On the right, you have a pure Hodge structure of YK because it is smooth projective. On the left, you have a mixed Hodge structure, but we know that the YK part, the smallest part, it is I already mentioned this, it is coming from the image of the restriction map from HK of X bar to HK of X. So it is a set of cohomology classes on X which extend over X bar. And that's it, you apply the strictness result in Delligne theorem. By strictness, on the right, you have HK equal WK HK. So the image of HK, the image of this map here, is the same as the image of this map here, just by a weight argument, by a strictness. Okay, so I should stop here. I just, I knew more or less that I would not have time to mention this. I wanted to add something about, just to show you this, not saying more, about the fact that I have been discussing the things from the viewpoint of complex geometry, complex manifolds. I wanted to insist now on the fact that if you work in complex projective geometry, you can apply the Gaga principle. And then the Gaga principle, it says that the things that we have computed, the HQ of the HPQ, for example, the HQ of X value of omega X to the P, these things that can be computed purely algebraically. So in fact, that means that it depends only on the data of your complex algebraic variety over C. You can introduce the algebraic Durham complex and then the Gaga principle will tell that the hypercohomology of the algebraic Durham complex, it is the same as the hypercohomology of the analytic Durham complex. So that shows that the Bethic homology with complex coefficients, in fact, it can be computed by a purely algebraic meaning. And so there are generalizations of that to the relative setting and very important part of the theory of variation of Hodge structures that the Hodge bundles are algebraic, the cosine connection is algebraic, etc. But I should stop now.
Oh, great talk. Are there questions?
People can use the Q&A chat box if they want to ask questions. They can type them out.
Are there questions?
We do have. What can be said about the non-algebraic singular case?
You have to be careful because you have to make sense of Keller space. In fact, you can. I think that presumably, what works very well is suppose that you have a compact, or no compact, let's do the compact case. A compact analytic space, so some singular, but admitting a desingularization which is scalar. The Deligne theory will apply in that case. If it is both singular, I think that similarly you could take on this species which will be defined as the Keller compact Keller analytic species, take analytic Zariski open set that is the complement of a closed analytic subset. You can also do the Deligne theory because the Deligne theory it does not use the polarizations. It just does Hodge theory. Well, of course, you have to do the theory of desingularization, but you have the main ingredients. Of course, you need the Hironaka resolution theorem. You apply it to construct what Deligne calls the hyper resolutions. What I want to say is that in fact, you will do Hodge theory at the end on various species like this normal crossing divisor. So you have the successive intersections. But you don't need the polarization. So in fact, basically, once you make the right definition of being Keller, which is more or less maybe the synchronization in the scalar or being dominated by properly dominated by your smooth scalar.
I'm not seeing any other questions, so I would suggest we thank the speaker for a wonderful talk.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Okay.
Nice talk.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Okay.